Everybody else has a chance to sign in.
It's on autofocus.
The 100 is not good about autofocus sometimes.
Right there. Okay.
Which one is one? Okay.
I guess that's it. Okay. We're going to get started here. We have 7 o'clock. This is the Zoning Board of Appeals meeting. We have one item on the agenda tonight, case number 16-02, which is a 40B project, chapter 40B project, for 3941 Lincoln Street, 212 Prescott Street. Is the applicant here tonight? Okay. Not yet. Let me go ahead and read the legal notice, and we have some criteria to go through here, and then we'll give you your time to make a presentation. I will go ahead and read the legal notice now on this. The Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing in the Great Room at the Pleasant Street Senior Center, 49 Pleasant Street in Reading, Massachusetts, on Thursday, February 4th, 2016, at 7 p.m. on the petition of MKM Reading LLC, who seeks a comprehensive permit to develop 77 units of rental housing on a 36,064 square foot residentially zoned tract of land under Massachusetts General Laws Chapter 40B, Sections 20 through 23, with waivers from zoning requirements on the property located at 39-41 Lincoln Street and 2-12 Prescott Street in Reading, Massachusetts. Unless there is an objection, I will dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that all abutters were notified, as were the following: Board of Selectmen, Town Clerk, Police Department, Fire Department, Building Department, Conservation Commission, Health Department, Assessor's Office, Engineering Division, CPDC, members and associate members of the Board of Appeals, as well as the planning boards of Wakefield, Linfield, North Reading, Stoneham, Woburn, and Wilmington. Testimony given before this board is taken under oath. So if you think you may want to speak tonight, please stand, raise your right hand, and I will swear you in. This is anybody from the public, this is the applicant, etc. If you'd like to stand, anybody that's going to speak tonight feels they want to make a comment or speak, please stand. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth. Responses, I do.
I do.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Applicant, if you would like to introduce yourself and then make a presentation.
Right.
That's fine by me.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, zoning board members, town officials, elected officials, employees of the town, members of the audience that are here tonight, those watching on TV. My name is Matthew Zucker from MKM Reading, New Meadow Development. I'm here with Kenton Chase from New Meadow and Matthew Roman from New Meadow. In a moment, I'll also introduce the development team. We're very excited to begin the public hearing process for Reading Village tonight. A 77-unit development proposed at the Reading Commuter Rail Station. This is a process, and we look forward to hearing your comments, questions, and concerns, and working with all of you as we move forward with what we hope to be a collaborative effort. We just recently, as of today, sent out letters to all our direct abutters and hope to meet with them individually before our next public hearing to address any specific comments that they may have. We put a lot of work so far into the design and development of this project. Careful consideration was given to ensure that Reading Village met the goals and objectives of the 2005 Reading Master Plan, the 2007 Downtown Reading Market Assessment, and the December 2015 Draft Town of Reading Economic Development Action Plan. Reading Village is a transit-oriented 40B development on a currently blighted site. Transit-oriented developments create compact, pedestrian-friendly, high-density developments that encourage people to live, work, and shop near transit stations and decrease their dependence on needing to own a vehicle. Reading Village clearly accomplishes these goals. It's 150 feet door-to-door to the commuter rail. Within a half mile, there's three banks, a post office, at least six restaurants, a flower shop, a gym, a CVS, and a number of other local businesses. Reading Village will help promote downtown Reading growth by providing appropriate density at the train station, bring new residents downtown that will help local businesses that depend on getting new people in the door. Chapter 40B, as some of you know, is a state statute enabling local zoning boards like this one to approve affordable housing developments under the Comprehensive Permit Bylaw, which was enacted to address the shortage of affordable housing statewide. I'm sure we'll get into more detailed discussions about 40B and the process later on this evening. Multifamily density in downtown areas, especially those near transit stations, are becoming more and more dense as towns and the state have recognized that this is the most appropriate location for high density housing. Reading Village currently is 70% one bedroom units, whereas a typical 40B is closer to 30% one bedroom units. It's been designed to attract young professionals that use Uber, Zipcars, and mass transit and rely less and less on owning a vehicle. They'll walk to area businesses and spend money. This is largely not family housing and is not designed to meet larger household needs. Furthermore, Reading Village is much needed redevelopment of a long-standing, currently blighted site. Tonight, I have members of the development team here that they'll give a brief overview of their area, and as we move forward with the process, we'll get into, I'm sure, a lot more specific in details. Peter Partash from Cube 3 is the architect, who'll speak to the design approach and the architecture of the building. Jeffrey Durr from Vanessa & Associates will give an overview of the traffic study analysis that they performed. Jim Burke from DeSalle Burke Associates will give a brief overview of the civil engineering. Jeff Engler from SEB, a 40B expert, can discuss the 40B process and answer any questions you have. We truly believe Reading Village is soundly designed, economically viable, transit-oriented 40B development on a blighted site that will help advance the growth of the town and specifically the downtown. We look forward to the process again, and With that said, I will pass it off to Peter Bartash.
Thank you. Sitting, I'll start this. Good evening, Chairman, members of the board. Thank you very much for hearing me. For the record, my name is Peter Bartash. I represent Q3 Studio. We are the architect for this project. Tonight, I'd just like to take a quick overview of the plans, the way the building is sited, the way it relates to its surrounding context, and to discuss kind of briefly just the overall approach to the design and image of the building itself.
Peter, I can forward it for you.
Oh, awesome. Thank you. I was looking forward to the pre-pause. So here we're looking at the first floor plan. From a really high level, the project is configured as one floor of at-grade parking, and then there are four floors of residential building above that at-grade parking. And so we're looking at the first floor plan right now, which is at the level of the street. You have Prescott Street on the upper left-hand screen side of your screen. There is a corner parcel that is not associated with the project, and then you have Lincoln Street that turns the corner. It's on the upper right-hand side of the screen. So what you'll see is that the project is presenting roughly 170 feet of frontage along Prescott Street. That's where we're providing our primary vehicle access here at this lower corner of the building. And we're getting into the building and circulating through in between and behind the corner parcel. Thank you. I'm Paul. So we're circulating through the building behind this corner parcel, getting into the circulation through building D, finally exiting with a one-way out back onto Lincoln Street. You'll notice that we've taken some care in how we've designed the way the building hits the ground in order to start to pull some of the massing back from the street edge. The goal and one of the directives that we got from Matt and Ken is to make sure that we were maintaining a comfortable street edge that felt walkable, that felt friendly and engaging to the pedestrian experience and didn't just present a solid street wall along the front. As you get to building B, we have roughly 90 feet that's set along Lincoln Street, and up above, these two buildings are connected with a bridge that does bring this into one solid development, and we'll get into that a little bit more as we get further on in the presentation. Just to talk briefly about entry from a pedestrian standpoint, we do have a primary pedestrian entrance located here at the knuckle of the larger of the two buildings. And that is also set back from the street, allowing us to landscape and control the experience for users going to and from the building at this corner. That's where you'll find your elevator. That's where you'll find one of your egress stairs. And you'll note that some of the other egress stairs are located at the other ends of the building to provide adequate means of egress out from the residential structure above. You can see that all of the parking at this level exists on double-loaded drive aisles that are 24 feet in width. And they're all standard-sized spaces to allow for, you know, either small, mid, or large-sized vehicles to park in these locations. The parking does actually extend out past the edge of the building footprint from above. In this light blue area, that's where we have a courtyard space that's up a level and is at the second level of the project in the first residential level, which we'll see in a second. But I do want to point out that the parking does extend past the footprint of the building in order to allow us to maximize the parking layout here. Specifically, we do have 80 spaces, and we are providing one space per unit. And to Matt's earlier point about the relationship between the project and the train station and the size of the units and the goal of this as a transit-oriented development, the notion here is that with the train station being 150 feet door-to-door, and with this goal of this project to attract people who are using the train and using public methods of transportation, we're expecting a decreased level of demand that would be supported by one space per unit here. And if the project were to be 77 units and, you know, 70% two beds, let's say, I think that you could look at the parking ratio and think about it differently. But because we're talking about 70% one-bed units, which are on average anywhere from 750 to 800 square feet, they're smaller, they're going to drive a smaller, younger demographic that Matt and Ken are looking to attract. Here we're looking at the first residential level, so we're up one floor from the parking. Again, we have Prescott Street up in the corner, and we have Lincoln Street over here on the side. So as you filter up into the building, you have a double-loaded corridor with units on either side. We're giving these units primary views out onto Prescott Street, both in terms of accessing natural light, but also providing eyes on the street. You know, we want to go ahead and take, as Matt had said, this blighted site and really help it feel active and safe and encouraging for people who want to use this as a conduit from a pedestrian standpoint, walking down and toward the downtown area further on past the train station. So once you're inside the corridor here, if you were to filter down and walk along all the way to the outside, we do have the outdoor courtyard. This is a landscape amenity, outdoor amenity space for residents of the project. The goal of this space is to provide those residents with a consolidated outdoor space that they can enjoy, but also to provide some relief along the back side of the site and to pull the bulk of the mass of the building away from the nearby residential neighborhood. As you continue back through the corridor in the building and you connect through this bridge, you'll end up in the other building, which is similar in character to the main building here and just slightly smaller scale, providing us with some frontage on Lincoln Street. Typical floor plan, as you can see, is a continuation from the floor we saw below. The difference, obviously, is now you've dropped out from being able to see that courtyard, and the building just stacks all the way up through. Here we have the roof, and there are a lot of technical notes on the roof about its slopes, and I think once we see the elevations, they'll all make a little bit more sense, but the idea here is we are using a pitched roof aesthetic. And I want to make that point because that is a very important part of the architectural language for the building. We'll talk about height in a second, but obviously when you start to talk about using a pitched roof, you are adding a little bit of height to accommodate that roof slope. And now what we've done is two things. We've taken the roof and we've tried to lower the slope to the lowest extent possible. And then we've taken that roof and depressed it as far as we can into the upper floor itself. So what happens is we need to create these that are called dormers, that are shed-style dormers, so that they feel lower. And at the end of the day, when you're standing on the sidewalk, or you're anywhere really within a kind of 50 to 100 foot range around the building, all you're seeing is that cornice line along the edge, and you're seeing that there is a sloped roof and it does slope away, but you're not perceiving the uppermost pitch of the roof at the top of the project. So in a nutshell, this is actually probably one of the most important aspects of the design, as much as it's also the least interesting to look at least for me anyway. This section helps illustrate some of the points I was talking about before relative to the parking that exists at grade. Out here is where you have Prescott Street. We have the parking that opens up to the back of the property where we saw that we have parking spilling out beyond the edge of the footprint of the podium above. We do have the four floors of residential situated on top of that parking level. Here's that outdoor courtyard. And then you can see the way the roof is designed. So if I were to have taken this section cut at a different point in the building where we don't have these dormers, this roof would continue straight through here and connect down to the soffit line that we have that continues around the building. At moments where we needed headspace to create this unit, what we ended up doing is introducing that dormer to create that livable space and to get windows at this upper floor. And so that's what I meant when I said this roof is pushed down onto that top floor. Traditionally, what would happen is this spring point would actually occur up here. So you'd be adding another kind of 10 feet to your building height if we hadn't tried to depress the roof. Looking at the elevation. So taking a break from the pointer for a second, the idea behind the aesthetic here is to really capture the notion of this train station and this idea of kind of this old school train language. At the same time, we're not trying to be 100% historic and represent something that was built in a different time period. We want to be modern, we want to use modern materials and colors and fenestration in order to really create a modern language that has roots in the past and references older design without trying to mimic it in a kind of an artificial way. And so some of those elements I'm talking about specifically include things like the brackets and the deep overhanging roofs. Those are elements that we've seen traditionally used in train station architecture. And I think when you look at the existing train station building right nearby, you start to see that sort of language of those low, long roofs. And we wanted to really capture that. At the ground floor, this is actually where your parking occurs. And here's your entrance to your parking level. Here's that point we talked about entering the building. And this is where I have to give Matt and Ken a lot of credit for pushing us a little further. In most developments of this type, this is an untreated edge where it's screened with some sort of industrial material. And it feels really cold and uncomfortable to walk against, but we recognize the importance of really treating the street edge properly along Prescott, and so we're going through the extra legwork of making sure that we're including glazing and we're including fenestration where we have these storefront windows, and we're carrying the building materials down on these piers, and we're creating this roof overhang along the front edge of the property to make it feel inviting and to make it feel comfortable to walk along and to travel along as you're moving from Prescott Street back toward the train station, or vice versa. In terms of overall massing and the way that we're breaking up the building, we've decided to take the primary mass of the building and bifurcate it with this central stair core that we have, but also to start to break down the mass along the length of the building. Because if you remember, from this edge to this edge, we're looking at roughly 170 feet along the length of Prescott Street. And then we've introduced this language of recessed bays to add a little bit more texture and rhythm as you move along the facade. And in traditional architecture, you get a kind of base, middle, top hierarchy for the way that the project would be designed to help break down scale and manage mass. And we've taken that and reinterpreted it in a modern way by creating this strong linear base element using this roof, letting the body of the building be relatively unbroken and modern, which is more in line with the contemporary aesthetic, and letting the roof really be that upper cap, the top of the building. Again, the roof is pushed down, and these are the dormers I was talking about, where those units do push through and create those dormers that allow you to have the extra space you need to get head height within those units themselves. Looking at the side elevation of the building, you can see that we take that language, and we do carry it around the corner. The one interesting thing about this, well, there are many interesting things about this project, but one of the most interesting to me is the fact that this building really doesn't have a single front face. It's very exposed on all four sides. And so we need to be cognizant of making sure that the design language is consistent around all faces of the building so that whenever you're standing on Prescott Street, if you're on Lincoln Street, if you're in the neighborhood just behind it, we want to make sure that the face we're presenting to you is of the same quality and character as the primary image of the building. So looking briefly at some shadow studies and light and just impact on the surrounding grade, I do want to point out that this is our massing model of the building that we're proposing, and it is overlaid on a Google Earth aerial. And what you'll see in the kind of background is this outline of a shadow from the existing building. What I don't want is for you to think that that shadow is at the same time as this slide of the study. We're going to look through a couple of these to demonstrate what I mean, but this shadow that's captured in this picture is taken at a different time of year than the shadow that we're demonstrating on December 21st at 10 a.m. So we'll see how those start to move in line as we move through different times of the year looking at the shadow impacts. The existing building that sits right here on the corner of the site is roughly between 40 and 45 feet in height. And to the ridge line that we talked about, where that roof really springs up, we're looking at 52 feet. So from a scale, mass, and height perception along that street edge, there really is not much of a difference in overall height from this building to what's there right now. But on December 21st, and this is the day of the year where we have the longest shadows, you'll see that this shadow does spill out across Prescott Street and start to just touch some of the neighboring properties across. But this is at one time of the year on the worst day to look at shadow studies. So if we start moving through some of the others, you'll see that for a majority of the year, those shadows are actually pulled back and have little to no impact on the abutters across Prescott Street. And so now all of a sudden we're getting later in the day and we're already moving to the point where we're impacting a corner of this building, but we're not touching anyone here. And we're not even touching the train station from the other building we have sitting on Lincoln. Looking at 2:30 on December 21st, this is about the longest shadow you're going to get in the evening just before the sun is going to set. And now we're back in the summertime when shadows are much more vertical, and you can see this outline here is actually within the extents of the existing shadow we've got on the ground here at this point. So we're actually being pretty sensitive to the neighbors across the street in terms of how we're trying to avoid impacting light and access to light and just open air as well. And we'll keep going through.
Do you want to talk about spring?
Spring? So springtime, we're at a little bit of in between the extremes of the winter and the summer. And this would be consistent for what you would see in the fall, too, at the vernal equinox, I believe. You have the shadow falling just across the edge of Prescott and touching the pavement here as we get to the sidewalk on the other side, but it falls short of touching these abutting properties across the street. And you can see here that we're not even casting a full shadow on Lincoln Street at this time. I think it, ultimately what really concerned us the most is making sure that we weren't doing anything to affect the access to light for these properties on this side of the development here, which is easy because they're on the north side, so it wasn't too hard. We'll just keep moving through, keeping with these, yeah. And so that, in a nutshell, is the architecture, and so we'll pass it on next to, do you want to talk about traffic? All right, so Jeff will be up next to talk about traffic.
Thank you. Good evening. For the record, my name is Jeffrey Dirk. I'm principal with Vanessa Associates, and we're the traffic engineers for the project. As a part of the application that you have, there's a full traffic study in there. I'm going to go through some of the findings of the traffic study. They tend to be quite technical. I'm going to talk about some numbers relating to the project and traffic volumes on the roadway network, and certainly be able to answer questions that you might have relative to those numbers themselves. So what I'm showing on the slide here is basically the project site. In this location here, you see the train station and the ETA tracks behind that. And then what I'm showing in these orange circles, these are the intersections that we looked at in the traffic study. When we're assessing the impacts of the project, we're looking at a number of things relating to the development. We're looking at the speed of traffic on these roadways. We're looking at traffic volumes, obviously, and seeing how the project interacts with that. As Matt had mentioned, an important part of this project is the fact that it's transit-oriented. In order for it to really, truly be transit-oriented, obviously we need to be close to a train station or some type of public transportation service. But the also important thing is that we have that connectivity to those services. And connectivity means that it's walkable, that you don't need to get in your car to get to that site. And that it's also bicycle-friendly. Not only are the roads bicycle-friendly, so you can ride your bike over to the train station, or walk over, but also that as we look at the site itself, and you heard about the architecture of the garage, we want to make sure that we have accommodations for bicycles so that you're able to park a bicycle out of the weather inside of the site itself. So all of those things from our standpoint allow us to reduce the traffic demands and also the parking demands that you would heard. But focusing on the study area, so these three intersections, basically it's the corners that bound kind of the triangle area around the site. So the Lincoln Street intersection with Prescott Street. This is Prescott and Washington, and then this is Washington where the Lincoln Street had this area here. So those are the three intersections that we looked at, and we also looked at, obviously, the entrances and exits to the project site itself. So the first thing that we need to do in conducting the traffic study is we need to have a good understanding of the existing conditions in the area. So as I mentioned, we measured speed of traffic on these roadways going by the site, and that's important as we look at the positioning of the driveways because we want to make sure that there's adequate lines of sight, so someone exiting the property can be able to look to the left or right and see a vehicle or a pedestrian that's walking on the sidewalk and safely exit the property itself. Also important is you're a motorist driving along Prescott Street. If someone pulls out of the site, you want to make sure you can see them and then safely stop if the vehicle happens to pull up in front of those areas. So speed is the determining factor in the lines of sight that are required. Traffic volumes in this area, we measure two different ways. The first way is we use those rubber road tubes that you often see on the road. We leave those up there for several days so that we can look at the traffic profile over the course of the day. What it also allows us to do is we perform turning movement counts, so physically having people stand at these intersections and they count vehicles going through the intersection, the types of vehicles, and then whether they're turning left or right at the intersections themselves. Those rubber road tubes also allow us to make sure that as we have people go out and do the counts at these intersections, we want to make sure that we're counting the peak hours, the highest traffic volume periods. So the road tubes and those 24-hour, 48-hour counts that we do allow us to make sure that we're counting, in fact, capturing the peak traffic flow in the area themselves. So just some statistics in terms of what we found in the area. Prescott Street, the vicinity of where the site is, it accommodates just shy of 4,000 vehicles per day. So if you stood out there and you counted everything that went by you in two directions and you stood out there for 24 hours, that's about the number you'd arrive at in that area there. Lincoln Street in this area, given the fact that it's closer to the train station, is about 5,000 vehicles. There's about 1,000 more vehicles on that roadway than to another Prescott Street side. One of the unique characteristics that you have is if you looked at the 24-hour volume numbers and then you look at the highest traffic volume hour during the day, and that tends to be the evening peak hour, about 10% of that daily volume is going to happen during the peak hour. So we looked at those numbers, so about 4,000 per day going by the site. About 10% of that happens during the peak traffic volume hours, so it's about 400 vehicles, and that's two-way traffic. And then we've got about 500 vehicles in this area here on Lincoln Street itself. So I talked about pedestrian and bicycle facilities. That's also an important piece of what we look at. We want to make sure that we have safe, available accessibility to the train station in this case. This site, in terms of its location, we're showing in the slide here the dotted lines you see are where sidewalks are located. So we went out and looked at where are sidewalks, where are they in relation to the site. And then the orange that you see here, this is where the crosswalks are. So what you see relative to where the site is you can see it's very walkable over to the train station, that there are crosswalks at the major intersections that allow for people to be able to cross at the train station. We also noted that Prescott Street, it has share the road signs, so it's a bicycle facility. In fact, the town's promoting bicycle connectivity over to the train station. And all of the roadways in this area here are safe and efficient for accommodating not only pedestrians, but also bicycle travel. So that's an important piece as well. The other thing, as I mentioned, that we look at vehicle travel speed. So when we're measuring the volume of traffic with the rubber road tubes, we're also measuring the speed of traffic. So we measure the speed of traffic on Prescott Street and Lincoln Street over 2 days. So if it's 4,000 vehicles per day, we measure the speed of 8,000 vehicles on Prescott Street and the speed of 10,000 vehicles on Lincoln Street during those time periods. In this area, there is no posted speed limit. So by Massachusetts general law, the enforceable speed limit on these roadways is 30 miles an hour, given the fact that it's not posted and the type of land use that's in this area. The predominant travel speeds, and when I mentioned predominant speed, if we measured, as I mentioned, 8,000 vehicles, the predominant travel speed is a speed at which 85% of those vehicles traveled at or below. It tended to be around 30 miles an hour, so it's pretty close to what the enforceable speed limit is. And we found the same thing along Lincoln Street. The average of prevailing travel speed was about 30 miles an hour as well. And the reason for that can have to do with the fact that you have the train station here, there's a lot of activity happening, so the speeds tend to be a little bit more in line with what you'd expect in this type of a neighborhood area, so generally around 30 miles an hour. The other thing that we look at is safety, and when we look at safety, it's not only looking at the way that the geometry of the roads and the intersections are actually designed, we correlate that and look at motor vehicle crash histories at these intersections. We look at a five-year time period. When we look at the information that's available through the Massachusetts Department of Transportation, so if there's a crash in this area and it's reportable, meaning that it resulted in either personal injury or a property damage accident that exceeded $1,000, and you're supposed to report that not only to the local police department but also into the Registry of Motor Vehicles. So we have that information available to us for the past 5 years, and we look at the number of crashes that are happening in relation to the volume of traffic on the roadways. So that allows us to kind of normalize the crashes so that you can compare crashes throughout the town. And it's basically measured on the number of crashes per million vehicles either going traveling along the roadway or at an intersection. And then we can take that crash rate and compare it to state average. And if it's above that state average, then we generally focus a little bit more detailed work with the local police department to find out exactly what's happening at the intersections themselves. I'm happy to report that in this area, there were no locations that exceeded the state crash rate. So as we look at pedestrian facilities, bicycle facilities, volume of traffic, speed of traffic, and then the crash rates that are happening, what that is saying to us is that there's no inherent safety deficiencies in this area. So that's one good thing as we kind of move on to the next level, which is to see what the impacts of this project would be. So as we look at impacts of the project, we're not only looking at our existing conditions today, we want to make sure that this roadway network and the project itself will function in the future. And per state standards, what we're required to look at is a 7-year planning horizon. So we need to look at conditions today, which in the case of the traffic study, it was published in 2015. So our 7-year planning horizon that we're looking at is the year 2022. And in order to establish that future horizon, we worked with the town to look at general traffic growth trends in the town. So if there's no other development in the area and you just had increases in ownership of automobiles and households or in adjacent communities having development and that traffic going through the town, how do traffic volumes generally change on the roadway network? Now that's what's known as just general background traffic growth. Nothing else happened in this area and traffic volumes just increased. What would that look like? The other piece to the future horizon here is those projects, physically projects that the town has approved or are currently in the permitting process that have not yet been constructed, and they will add traffic onto the roadway in those in the future as well as they get established. So the general historic growth in the town, if we look at the past 10 years, traffic volumes have generally grown at less than 1% per year, and that's not uncharacteristic for this area and most of the region itself. So what we use as a growth rate is a 1% per year, and it's compounded annually. So as we start to get more interest now in our checking accounts, it works the same type of way. So we grow our traffic volumes, take the existing numbers that we accounted, and they've grown 1% per year over 7 years compounded annually. The town identified two projects for us to include in the traffic study. It was the Redding Woods project, which needs to, I don't know if it's maybe under construction, but has been fully built out, so we included the traffic from that project. There was also an enrichment center in this area that's going to be constructed, and so it includes a daycare center as a part of that. So we included the traffic from that project as well in our future conditions. So the future conditions, it's 1% a year, growing 7 years in the future, and then those two projects are included in our traffic volume projections. So the next thing is, how much traffic is this project going to generate? So at a 77-unit apartment community, we're able to look at what's known as trip generation statistics. They're published by the Institute of Transportation Engineers. And basically what that is it's a clearinghouse of traffic volume information. So if you know a specific type of land use, they have data that's been published over the past 50 years and it's continually updated. And what it allows us to do is go in there and knowing the land use, in this case apartments, we can go into that manual and look at the number of units. And basically what it tells us is if you have a certain number of units, it's going to generate a certain volume of traffic. So if we apply those statistics to the project at a 77-unit development, we're able to arrive at these numbers here, and I'll just walk you through these numbers. So the top number, which is the large number, that's the 24-hour number. So as we talked about 4,000 vehicles per day going by the site, we expect this project at 77 units, and I do want to mention there's been no credit taken for public transportation use. So basically what this is saying is if we took this project and we built it out in the middle of a field someplace and there was no available transportation opportunities and everyone had to use their car, that's what these numbers represent. Basically, so we're not taking credit for that type of usage. So on a 24-hour basis, we're expecting the project would generate 590 vehicle trips. It's 295 entering and 295 exiting. So these numbers were always going to be two-way. So the total volume, and again, so if you stood at the access points of the property and you stood there for 24 hours, counted everything in and everything out, that's the number that you arrive at. Again, with no adjustment for public transportation or pedestrian bicycle trips. We also look at these two numbers here. Now these are the peak hours. So as a residential project, this represents basically the first number is in the morning. So the highest traffic volume hour between 7 and 9 in the morning, so this is when you're going to work in the morning essentially, and this is the highest 1 hour period between 7 and 9 in the morning, the project we expect will generate about 41 vehicle trips. So you can see the bulk of that 33 would be exiting, a small amount, 8 would be entering. This number here is the same condition in the evening. So this is the highest traffic volume hour between 4 and 6 in the evening. So this is when people are generally coming home from work. And we expect the project will generate about 60 vehicle trips, most of it coming in, 39 coming in, and 21 going out. A common question we get is, if you have 77 units, how come you don't have 77 cars going out or coming in during these time periods? And the reason for it is basically, if we looked at the profile of the traffic over the course of the day for the project, what you're going to see is it's going to come up and it's going to peak somewhere between 7 and 9 in the morning, and then it's going to drop off, and then it's going to back up in the afternoon. So what these numbers represent is the top of that peak. So if you go on either side of the peak, the numbers will be less than that. It kind of ramps up, it hits this number, and then it goes back down. And I really use it as an example of, if you kind of looked at your household and your neighbor's household, I may leave and go to work at 6:30 in the morning, and my neighbor may leave and go to work at 8 o'clock, let's say, in the morning as well. So we're not all leaving at the same time. The same thing happens with the apartment community, and that's really why these numbers don't correlate to 77 vehicles coming in and out during the peak time periods. So once we've understood the volume of traffic the project is going to generate, we have to see how is it going to distribute itself onto the roadway network and through the intersections we're studying, as well as the utilization of the driveways. So what this slide shows here is basically as we take the 41 vehicles in the morning and the 60 in the evening, how it's going to relate itself to the roadways, which roads are going to be used, which intersections is this traffic going to travel through. And the way that we come up with this pattern that you see here, we start with the U.S. Census data. So as you report on the U.S. Census, where you live and where you go to work and how you get to work, all of that information is published. We're able to take a look at that. And specific for Reading, we can take a look and see for residents in Reading, where do they go to work and how do they travel to work? So this is the first piece of information we use. So we know generally we can look at the population in the town, home ownership, and journey to work data. And we start with that information. And from that information, we can refine it based on the traffic counts that we do. So once we understand how many people work in Boston, how many are going to Wakefield, how many are going to Stoneham to work, we can look at the traffic volumes in this area here, look at the roadway network, and then figure out how you get from this site in particular to each of those employment centers. And that's what you see on the slide here. So basically, what we're showing is about 35% of the traffic we expect is going to be on Prescott Street. It's traveling to the southwest. We've got 20% of the traffic traveling, that's Minot Street there. 35% is heading on Washington Street across the tracks. And then we have another 10% heading to the north on Lincoln Street. So that's the distribution of traffic. So as we take those traffic volumes I showed on the last slide, we just apply these percentages, and that's how the traffic is going out and is coming back in the evening itself. So the next thing that we do is once we've understood all of this, we need to see what are the impacts of the project. So as we're looking at impacts, we're measuring a couple things. We're measuring motorist delays at these intersections. So as you come up to the Washington Street intersection Prescott Street, you come up to the stop sign and you wait a certain amount of time because there's cars going by you. So we look at what that delay is, how long are you physically waiting there? And then those delays also translate into backups. So we look at the number of vehicles that are queued up at an intersection to make a left or right hand turn at a stop sign and see what the changes are before and after we add the addition of the project's traffic. Now, if you do have the opportunity and you want to look at the traffic study itself, you see a table in there. And that table, it has all of this information, but you'll also see these letter grades, A through F. And what those letter grades are is it's just like a report card that you have at school, where it's reporting how these intersections are operating, with an A being the best conditions, an F considered a failing condition. And it's taking those delay measurements, those Q measurements, and it's correlating to them to those letter grades. So it's basically simplifying that process. So you can just look and see how these intersections operating in relation to standard report card grades. Now, what's determined to be the limit of acceptable traffic operations, just like a report card, is a D. So when you're just passing, if you have a D. So ideally, what we want to have at these locations, we want all locations to be operating that are D or better. But certainly with a project, what we want to see is where are there any changes in those letter grades? Where are we degrading or causing ourselves to go from an A to a B or C to a D at any of these locations? So as we looked at the relationship of this project to these operating conditions at these intersections, what you generally see is all of the intersections that we found that are existing and going out in the future with or without the project, all movements were D or better. So we didn't find any conditions at these intersections where the operating conditions of the delays were so excessive that they fell below what the acceptable levels would be. Now, in looking at what the impacts of the project were, we did see that there were minor changes in levels of service, those letter grades during one peak period. Basically, we had a degradation from an A to a B or a B to a C, so it wasn't significant. What we did look at is when those degradations happened, what happened to the backups at the locations? What we found is those backups, or the increase in the queue, was no more than one vehicle. In fact, in most cases, there was no changes in the queue, even though the delays went up slightly. So in summarizing everything that we had done and looking at the impacts of the project, we generally found that there was no significant impact resulting from the project, that the transportation infrastructure, there was sufficient capacity to accommodate the project itself. And as I mentioned, we had pedestrian and bicycle facilities. We had a lot of connectivity relating to the project. So as we focused in on the project and looking at improvements, we did take a look at the lines of sight of the driveways and made some recommendations relative to ensuring that we maintain safe sight lines. As you're familiar with the area, there is on-street parking, and one of the key things in relation to the driveways and where they're positioned And this goes for any intersection. We typically don't want to see parking right up to a driveway or right up to an intersection because it does limit your sight lines. And typically what we recommend is that you prohibit parking one parking space on either side of the driveway, so it's basically 20 feet on either side. We recommend no parking. The same would happen at the intersections. I don't believe you have parking right up to the intersection, but to maintain sight lines, you want to make sure you don't have parking right up to the intersection. So we provided some recommendations relative to that. The other recommendations that you'll see that we have deal with making sure that we have safe pedestrian access, that we're connecting up to those pedestrian facilities, and then, as was mentioned, specific on-site amenities to encourage the residents to use public transportation as well. So there's a whole host of items that we identify that we will do as a part of the project internally and management-wise to make sure that we're encouraging residents to use public transportation. So that concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Jim Burke. I'm a civil engineer for the site, and I'll be brief, I promise. You heard from the architect, and he had some excellent points to make about the building itself, and the traffic engineer certainly the traffic moving around the site, very important to everyone in the neighborhood. What I'm about really is seeing this is the existing conditions of the site here. My job is to make sure that the building fits on the site, and you know, we get the utilities and the drainage to work properly. In this particular site, you have basically that 36,000 square feet is paved. You have a little bit of grass over here. There is a little pervious area here, but essentially that site is paved. All of it's running off to abutting properties. There's no stormwater control whatsoever. You have utility connections for each building over here for sewer and water, power, same over in this location here. The public utilities for water and sewer running down each street, Prescott and Lincoln. Next slide. This pretty much is a layout, kind of just shows the parking. We've kind of gone over that already with the architect, so it does show a little extra green space around the building, so we've actually increased the pervious areas for the property. By definition, runoff of the site will be less. But we've actually improved the stormwater management for the site. Next slide, please. One more. Sorry. So this is how we took care of the stormwater from the site. This here is 30 Cultec chambers. Over here we have 10. Capturing the roof runoff and recharging into the ground. The soils on site, we did some testing, excellent sandy gravels to find its Merrimack, an A-type soil, very receptive for stormwater recharge. So the roof runoff is all going to be put into these chambers here. We're going to be buffering the 2, 10, 25, and 100-year storms. We have a significant reduction in 2 years, 80%. All the way up to about 20% for the 100-year storm event for off-site flow. We do have a little bit of runoff, you know, that doesn't go into these chambers here. It's the parking area that sneak underneath the building. So this is a impervious area captured by a catch basin right here with a connection going to the drain line in the street. As I said earlier, there really is no stormwater concern. The civil aspects of this particular project, given the fact that the site was developed earlier and we're kind of reducing the development on it, made it kind of easy to fit into the property and for the surrounding neighborhoods. We do have service utilities for sewer and water, fire protection and the like. We talked to the engineering department and we're working with them to fine-tune the details of those particular connections. And that's about it for civil.
My name is Jeff Bengler. I'm with the firm SEB. We're 40B developers and consultants. You'll be happy to know I do not have any slides, and I'll be very brief. my comments are mostly for the benefit, I think, of the people in the audience and really less so for the board, but it's about the process in general. It's important to, for people to know there's not expectations tonight that we're going to be getting a permit from the board. It's a very iterative process. We've made a presentation, we've talked about architecture, we've talked about traffic, we've talked about civil engineering. And the town will have the opportunity to drill down in any or all of those areas relative to additional information. Or in other words, we have questions, we would like to see more detail, please explain this to us, we're not convinced. That's part of the process, so we would anticipate going through this iterative process. Likewise, the neighbors have questions for us through the chair relative to, could you help me understand this? I've worked on a lot of projects, and I can say with honesty that the team that Matt and Ken have assembled is quite good. They're really good in their fields, and I think the board should feel comfortable knowing that they're dealing with professionals. The other thing that's important to know, and I'm not looking for brownie points here, but the legal counsel that's been retained by the town is also a 40B expert, and he's here to represent the town interest, your interest, make sure we stay in line, and that's Council Haverty. He's really good. He's been through many, many 40B projects, and he understands the process, he understands the law, and I quite honestly work with many zoning boards that don't get good guidance, that don't have good direction, that don't understand the process. It makes it very difficult on the developer, it makes it even more difficult on the municipality. So I'm confident that this process will be managed pretty effectively and efficiently, thanks in large part to his involvement, because he gets it, so to speak. So I would just conclude by saying, once again, this is an iterative process. We look forward to the dialogue. I'm sure there'll be lots of questions as we move forward, and we stand ready to answer the questions, and as my client has indicated, hopefully have a collaborative process. But certainly happy at any point to answer any of the process questions, administrative questions. The other thing I'll mention, and this isn't to toot our own horn, but our firm also does more of the affirmative marketing and lease up of the affordable units than any other company in the state. So for 40B projects or special permit projects, we were involved in Johnson Woods, we were involved in 30 Haven. We handle all the affirmative marketing, the outreach to people that are interested in qualifying, whether it be a rental project or a home ownership project. So the extent, I only raise that because a lot of times there's questions relative to that process, local preference, how does the affordable housing process work. We can also answer all those questions, both for members of the board and for the neighbors. So with that said,
one last real quick comment.
Sure.
If you could go back, maybe the first civil slide. Alan brought pictures of the site and shared those with everyone. I think many of the neighbors obviously know the site. I'm sure members of the board know the site. It's one of those sites that I think the pictures do it justice and not in a good way. I think if you could go to the site now, you'll see that the building on Prescott Street is literally at the property line. In addition, the building on Lincoln Street is at many of the property lines, and the whole site is—it's not just paved, and it's just—it's there's other parts of the business that have been on the site for a number of years. So it's a whole thing, not just the buildings of the site. It's the buildings, the pavement, and the other apparatus and items that are on the site that kind of, I would say, make it a blighted site there. So I just wanted to point that out, and if pictures would help the board, I'm certainly happy to bring them, but I think the site speaks for itself in its current condition.
Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
I believe that concludes the applicant's presentation here, the initial presentation anyway. And we can go to board members now, and then after the board members have some questions, comments, etc., that they may have of the applicant, I'll open it up for public comment. Why don't we start, David? Any comments, questions you have right now? Knowing this is, you know, very, very preliminary right now, initial stage of the project that we've all heard about. And you know, any questions that you might have or comments, feel free.
Well, I'd like to defer to the chair a little bit on how I move forward with my line. My instinct is to look directly at, go directly off of the Mass Housing Approval Letter, and perhaps go through the items that were raised by Mass Housing, the bullet points, and perhaps mm-hmm. the recommendations, requirements, and maybe ask the applicant to go through those to the extent they already haven't been addressed, so that the board and those here get an understanding of how the applicant intends to comply with the letter and the spirit of the Mass Housing Approval.
That's fine.
Is that fair?
That's okay. Fair, David, sure. Okay, you're familiar with the Mass Housing letter that we all have, yeah. I think what David's asking is, if you go through there, if you remember that letter, there were a number of points brought up by the town before, in, I guess, your initial meeting with the town selectmen, et cetera, and town employees. And there were a number of issues that Mass Housing noted would be addressed down the line here, and I believe that's what David's asking now. Can you address some of those?
I'll just go on through them.
Sure.
Start on page 3, I believe, of the Mass Housing.
Right.
The first one is compliance with all state and federal environmental laws, regulation standards, to reduce construction, stormwater management. That is part of, I would say, the process you go through with the town consultants in-house or outside consultants that the town hires to make sure civil engineering works, utility works, the drainage works, that the building complies with all regulations, construction, environmental. There's no wetlands on the site, so we don't have that here. So the first one is kind of part of the process that we're going through. The potential traffic impacts, submitted a traffic analysis and study and heard from our traffic engineer, Jeff Ness. And I'm sure as we go through the process, the town will have questions on that, and we're more than happy to collaborate and go through that process. But I think we've addressed that right now. The proposed density for the development, as I said, transit-oriented developments at train stations throughout the state have become more and more dense as towns have realized that is the appropriate place to add density. We acknowledge that we are putting a dense building there. We looked at 30 Haven for some guidelines. We took their unit density and their retail that they have. I don't have the exact number per acre, but when you combine that with the retail, we thought we were in line with what had been already approved a little further away from more downtown, but further from the train station. So that helped us guide. We've talked about actually having retail and other commercial use at the site, but given traffic concerns that may come with that type of use and the viability, the financial viability of the success of what may be a retail there, we decided not to pursue it at that time, but it's something we have discussed with the town. The parking layout, it's a good question as to, what's the right amount of parking spaces for this number of units? I think as Peter said, if this was 70% two bedrooms, the standard is 1.25 on these developments. As you get closer to the train station, that number can get reduced 20 to 50%. There's studies locally and nationally on the use of the train station on projects near there. We are of the belief that the less cars is better for downtown and it promotes using downtown businesses. At the same time, we're sensitive. Their goal is not to not have enough parking so people have to park on the street. So as we go through the process with the town and we go through it internally and look at different ideas, that's one of the things we'll continue to look at is what our parking ratio is to units. From a unit standpoint, we have 77 units, 70% in one bedrooms. If we took that, which is a more traditional 30% for these developments, we could reduce the unit count 15, and our parking ratio would be at closer to 1.3 at that moment. We feel that the area and the target market we're going for, which is more of a young professional, and that's not to say we won't get all types of people there. They'll want to go downtown. They may not need a car. And the younger people really do rely on Uber and zip cars and all that stuff more. The size, scale, and architectural style of the proposed multifamily building, we've put a lot of time into designing this. We talked to the town. The architect came up with a number of ideas for us to look at from what is the more typical flat roof building that you'll see a lot of developments to different types of pitch. And we thought this building, while more costly, really fit the neighborhood of being more residential feeling, paying homage to the train station nearby. Clearly, height's been something that's going to be discussed. We could flatten that roof and make it a completely different looking building by almost 10 feet. You could just take off. It's the same exact building. I think the impact of that is really negligible of doing that. It doesn't really impact the shadow studies, the way the roof is pitched. So we've looked at that. We've looked at putting the parking underground, which is very cost prohibitive and would make the project uneconomical at this point. We've also looked at lowering the parking, but because of the site and the proximity of the train station, the size of the site, the area it would take to ramp down and the height requirements you need to get into the building would also, at some point, it just didn't work to actually physically be able to meet the code to get in the building. But we have looked at all those things and we'll continue to look at those things. We've heard height and density. And as I said, this is a process. So we've looked at some ways and we're open to suggestions on other ways to accomplish that. And we have some in mind that that we will pursue. But it's not that we haven't looked at it. And then the detailed planting plan identifying existing vegetation to be preserved. There really is nothing to be preserved, but we do acknowledge that we will put together a very detailed landscaping plan. Some of that will be in conjunction with talking to neighbors that are behind us individually. It may not just be planting on our property, but it may be planting plan that entails other people's property after discussions with them. So we're looking into all those things. We haven't done it yet because anything we add to the site in green space or landscaping is more than what's there now, and we will provide the board and the neighbors with mail delivery and snow removal is something else they cited that as we go through the process, it's a detail that will get worked out. And it's just something, there's bigger issues and items to deal with right now. So as we go through and work through some of those, we'll focus more on mail delivery and snow removal, but it will be important at some time for us to address and present you with. I think those were the points that they made, so I hope I at least gave a starting point for that discussion.
Right, thank you. I believe, too, and just to follow up on that, I believe you were in receipt of a memorandum from the town manager. We received it today, and I asked some of the people if you had received it. Granted, this is the first time we've seen it, too, but there is quite a lengthy memo with a number of bullets on it, too.
Right.
That we would, I certainly don't expect you to address it tonight. This is the first time we've seen it, probably the first time you've seen it. But, at some point we are going to need to address those.
Yes. Just to speak to that real quick.
We
received this. A lot of these comments we have heard before we've looked into.
Yes.
So we would be prepared. We look forward to meeting with the fire chief, hopefully, to discuss some of the concerns he had. Some of the other boards are reserving their comments until they have a meeting. I believe our meeting with the selection and community planning is the 24th?
23rd.
So
yes.
We look forward to that meeting with another presentation there. But I think the majority of these, obviously with the light department, and we still have continuing discussions with DPW, it's a long way from getting to that point, which it's preliminary, but those are important meetings and discussions to have separately with them to make sure everything works from their standpoint. And the other ones, we'll look forward to the 23rd, and we'll look forward to meeting with the fire chief and other people. So we have seen it, we have addressed it, and we'll continue to look at ways to address it.
Okay, thank you.
David, that...
That, well, I mean, it actually brings up some questions and some issues. So I think as a part of the process and as a part of the homework that you're going to have resulting from today's hearing would be, as you said, to flush out some of these issues. And in my estimation, a number of the areas that you addressed on the Mass Housing page, I would feel more comfortable having some sort of a peer review process. And I guess I'll defer to Attorney Haverty on how we want to put that together ultimately. But I think I'm by no means a traffic expert. You know, I think we obviously want to learn a little bit more about the parking, perhaps more about the drainage, certainly more about the public safety issues, and perhaps the town has in place, and maybe council has in place as well, a plan for us to put together some requests for, or even commission on behalf of the town, some review of that process. And perhaps we ought to put together a list of items and maybe include in that list some additional questions that we have arising out of the presentation tonight. And I guess I'll defer to the chair and to Attorney Haverty as to how we'd like to see that process go.
Yeah. I know, David, the town, and I have talked to the assistant town manager, town planner, etc. We will be having a consultant, I believe an engineering consultant, will be working with the town on the town's behalf in regards to reviewing, a peer review of a lot of the storm drainage calculations, the traffic report, et cetera, et cetera. And they'll be working with the developers team on that too, and coming to an agreement, you might say, on you know, what the numbers mean and how it's going to impact what the developer will do. So to answer your question, yeah, there will be outside consultants that the town will employ on this in regards to a lot of the engineering aspects.
Good, and the board will have some input into what those processes may look like.
Typically, what we will do is we'll work with through the town departments, and we would expect letters, memorandums, whatever you would like to call them, from each department in regards to the impacts and how they see this development is going to work in the area. So we would expect something from the engineering department, from the fire department, police department, etc., in regards to what the impacts are going to be and how they view this development in regards to their efforts on it. Yeah.
All right, Bob. And so would you recommend, or would we recommend asking questions now or withholding questions until we've had an opportunity for peer review or town departments to interject?
I think we could maybe hold on the question from the board. What I'd like to do is just get the board's comments, etc., right now,
okay,
like you did, and then we'll go to open this up for public comment too tonight.
All right.
And we'll go from there.
All right, a couple other points, if I might, then, Bob?
Sure.
One of the items that confused me, and perhaps the applicant already is working toward this, centered on some of the, and that was a great presentation by the Cube 3 folks, in the applicant's package back and forth, the minimum number of affordable units here is 20, correct? 25% of 77, 19 and a quarter, rounding up to 20. Your drawings are inaccurate. They represent 19 units as affordable units, so you might want to amend the drawings dated 16 December 2015. They show 19 units of affordable housing. And again, just homework.
Okay.
as part of your, part of what you're asking the board to do, in addition to the, well, as part of the comprehensive permit process, you're asking the board for certain waivers from the zoning bylaw in certain areas related to setbacks and, well, specifically density and setbacks. You know, I would imagine that some of these peer review studies would also enable the board to better answer some of the questions we might have related to the request for waivers. And so we'd ask that when you're doing your homework, that you include as much as you can that'll enable the board to make a decision related to the waivers you're asking for. And this is a request for, our, I guess, legal counsel for the town as well. One of the closing documents in every comprehensive permit would be an acknowledgement regarding a regulatory agreement. And before we sign off on it, I'd like to make sure that it passes statutory and regulatory muster. And I'm sure that's probably already on the list, but that's more for me than for for the town. And at this time, those are the only comments, I guess, that I have that aren't questions.
Okay, thank you, David. Kathleen?
Yeah. I think I have some concerns about the project that were highlighted in the previous letter, and I don't want to get too particular because I know there's a lot of people here tonight that would like to speak. I did just have two questions in regards to the traffic, just really quick. The first is, were the schools considered in terms of people coming and going for the schools? Because there are no buses in Reading for the middle school and the elementary school if you live within a mile. And I was just wondering if you were taking into consideration with all this talk of it being, you know, close to the train station, people, if there are children there, are going to have to get out to bring their kids to school. And I just had a question to find out if that was something that was considered.
It was. And, okay. And I think the, in a couple of different ways, so we have some recommendations relative mm-hmm. to making sure that everything's walkable and safe for the children to be able to
right.
walk to the, also important as well as when we were doing our traffic counts, that schools were in regular session. So that's also important.
Okay.
So we're making sure that we're reflecting the pedestrian activity and the school bus activity that happens when the schools are in session as well. So we started with a good baseline, and then as we looked at the project, wanted to make sure there's specific recommendations to make sure that it's safe for the school children.
And that even if people are taking the train, they're still going to be moving their cars
yes.
to take to school to come back to
yes.
get on the train. Okay. And then also in regards to the traffic study, did you look at when these trains are coming and going? And
we do. And that's a very important question because even as I'm talking about kind of the way these intersections operate,
mm-hmm.
anytime you're near a school or a train station, when
right.
the train comes in, there's a 15-minute period when just everyone's getting in their cars
right.
and leaving, so there's congestion. Those levels of service I mentioned are it's average over the day, but if you looked at that 15 minutes after the train came in, mm-hmm. there's generally gridlock in a lot of these locations. People get out,
okay.
people are walking and crossing the street. That's kind of normal activity that we expect to have. The project isn't going to so much exacerbate that, but that is a very good point, because that should be looked at, even though
right.
we're saying C or D or better.
Exactly.
That 15-minute period is going to be something more
significant. It is, absolutely. Okay. And again, I have additional questions. I do have concerns, not even just about the traffic, about the height of the building. Concerns for the fire chief that I think will be looked at mm-hmm. further going forward.
And the peer review will help.
Yes,
it's
exactly.
I always say results in a better project.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So that's all for now.
Thank you, Kathleen. John, anything you would like to question now or comment on?
This is the beginning of a process. The initial aspect of this process is the presentation this evening, but it's also an understanding of what a 40B is. So I have one first question. I don't know whether to ask the gentleman who is the consultant on 40Bs or I'll go back to Jeff. I don't know because how many people have let me ask just a point of question for the audience. How many people understand what a 40B is? Oh, a fair number. Okay. Let me ask you a pointed question then. You could have purchased this property. you could come before the town and ask for the same request. Why did you go for a 40B, and what are the limitations on a 40B from your side and from the town side?
I think the first part of your question is better addressed by the applicant. I think I would be willing to address the second, relative to the business decision. The second part I certainly can answer relative to the 40B process and what this means.
I would just say, I also sit on both sides of the fence, and I've done many 40Bs in my town. You know, the way current zoning is, and the way current zoning is here, you can always ask for use variances, density variances, height variances, and the legal threshold to get a variance of, you know, the unique shape, topography, soil conditions of a lot that's unique to your lot that doesn't apply to any lot. It would be an economic hardship not to grant the variance. Those, you know, one of the reasons why 40B was enacted was because of the hard requirements to get a variance in a town to promote affordable housing. So that is just the standard when you're looking at a site, especially one that's transit, that isn't zoned currently for that, a high density use, is the 40B avenue. It does provide needed affordable housing in the state, but the legal threshold to get a variance, under, if you apply for the same project, is, I don't think it's attainable. So
number one, the reason you're going this way is because Reading does not meet the affordable housing standard or minimum standard for the state of Massachusetts.
Correct. As I think it's a little over 7% now, and I could be wrong, but
seven,
I think that's the most current
subsidized
housing, 7.6. Mm-hmm.
We got a revised subsidized housing inventory today at 7.78%.
So that's part of, I've done many 40Bs in my town too on the other side, and have gone through, and I think the peer review process and that process is great, especially when you bring in a peer review consultants. It really helps both sides, the town, the neighbors, the developer, to come up with these. But the second part of the question,
that's
part of it. I want the people here to understand.
Well, I mean, basically, in a nutshell, I think I didn't see all the hands, but basically, in summary, and Council Haverty can certainly augment my answer. 40B was created because municipalities in general do not have good zoning mechanisms to create both multifamily housing and affordable housing. Now, to Reading's credit, they've done more housing than a lot of municipalities. I'm doing a project in Winchester, and in 40 years, okay, it's never had one 40B, it's never done one multifamily project. We're in Weston, we're in Wellesley, we're in towns like that. They've done virtually nothing. I have no problem kicking the money up there. Reading has done more to its credit. However, the threshold is twofold. There's one that's kind of esoteric about 1.5% of your total developable land area is dedicated to affordable housing. You're determined to have met that threshold. The other, which is more commonly understood and heard, is 10% of your total housing stock dedicated towards affordable housing. And by dedicated, it means deed restricted, either rental or for sale. Now, while Reading does have 7.78%, null set in that you're either 10% or above or you're not. So you could be at 9.5 or you could be at 1. In the state size, it's the same. So if you're not at 10%, the presumption is that the municipality needs more affordable housing. And thus, the threshold to which the municipality has to demonstrate to deny a project or impose certain conditions that really lower density, the threshold or the burden is really much more on the municipality. If the town is over 10%, which more towns are getting to that level, and one of the good things about this project is on a rental project, the entire project counts towards your affordable housing. So there's 77 units, and only 20 of them are restricted to people that qualify under the program. All 77 units will go towards that subsidized housing inventory, so Reading will be getting close to that 10%. So the option is that the town needs the affordable housing. And in summary, that's why an 40B project occurs, because it's very hard in the state of Massachusetts to build mixed-income multifamily housing. So I don't know if that did the job or Paul wants to add anything, but hopefully that explains the process a little bit more.
Well, I want people to understand, everybody, this is a review process, and what's requested in the package here is a list of waivers. A waiver, in essence, is a variance. This board doesn't treat variances very well. You must meet four criteria, and those four criteria are very difficult to get past, all four of them, not just three out of the four. The waivers are the same type of thing, but they're on the request before the town, because the town now, or the community, has got to look at that, because they have not met the threshold of 10%. So we can't just collectively, the town of Reading just can't walk away from this and say, we don't like what you're offering us, so we'll see you later. You have to go through this process. You have to really work on both sides to come up with some kind of an agreement that would work for the town. Otherwise, the state can come in and say, guess what? What would they tell us? All 77 units would go in at whatever height, and we would have nothing, the town, the boards, the selectmen would have no recourse at all. So we must go through this process. That's one thing that I wanted to make sure everybody understood. Second thing is that having sat on a number of 40Bs over the years in Reading, I expect that when we are doing this peer review, when we get a document from, let's say, the fire chief or the police chief or somebody in the engineering department or whatever, that the board is going to call a representative in for that to make their presentation on what they believe, the town believes, is needing to be done to move this project forward. It allows the board, it allows anybody who comes to the meeting to ask questions of that individual. It's not just a piece of paper and you take it, whatever it's worth, and you deal with it. The board, for most part, does not become involved in the initial portions of this whole process, so it needs to understand as much as you need to understand. So my expectation is that going as we go through this process, we're going to have representatives from each of the areas that are coming in to make a presentation to not only the developer, but to the board and to anybody who may have questions besides ourselves. That's how it gets resolved. And I do have, to go one step further, I do have a number of concerns in the package that we were presented, but it's too early in the process to go through that right now. Jeff?
Yeah, I would agree with everything. One of the things that we typically do, and I'd advise, you know, my client in this case, and we'll work with Julie, is to the extent that we can get a lot of the comment letters in a Word format, we can embed the responses to, like, each comment within the document. That way the town's not flipping back where the answers are here, here's the comment, here's the fire department engineer. We have, like, one working, breathing document where our, kind of all the answers are getting right there. And sometimes it takes two or three iterations. We might answer a question, and the peer review comes back and says, well, that's not exactly. So we'll endeavor to work with the town so that we're providing answers. And honestly, it benefits the client, the developer, to be thorough and responsive with the questions, because we want to move this process along. We want resolution. We want clarity on outstanding issues. Believe me, I've represented other clients that are like, oh, do we really have to do that? I don't want to spend money. I mean, I'm not saying it's just ask for whatever, we're going to do whatever, but to the extent that there's reasonable requests and it's an iterative process and working collaboratively, it's effective. And the other thing I would mention, there's been discussion of waivers, and clearly that's an important process. My recommendation is typically the waivers are discussed later in the process because the project might change. I mean, yeah, a lot of things, waivers become obsolete because something changes and we don't need a waiver, or the board asks to do something and we need a new waiver that's not in there. And then there's time at the end of the process to kind of go through the list and say, all right, let's look at the waivers, why do you need that, let's talk about that, as opposed to upfront. Some of the waivers might not end up being relevant at the end of the day. So, but the waivers are an important part of the process, and it's really kind of the fundamental components of any 40B application. So, and also in this town, not the this site, we've been on projects where there's literally, like I'm sure Paul has, 100 waivers because you have septic and you have wetlands and you have other environment, you have hazardous material and you have other things. It's voluminous in terms of all the bylaws, general bylaws, zoning bylaws, Board of Health, whatnot. Not to diminish what we've asked for here, it's certainly important, but in terms of the sheer number of waivers, I'm confident I think we can get through them because it isn't so voluminous.
And I don't know how, I think what you're trying to do is share, is to get through what comes to the board has and then see if there are specific questions that we need to get from the audience who are here this evening,
sure.
And then move on, because this is, as I said, it's a process. It's not going to be done in one meeting or two or three or maybe four. We've had two 40Bs that have gone almost a year in length before they got finalized. Not that this would go that long, but you have to realize that they're, the larger the project, the more involved it is to get past that threshold that both parties can live with.
Mr. Chairman, if I could address that point.
Yes, yes, sir.
I understand that in prior circumstances, the board has taken upwards of a year or more. I mean, I've been involved in 40B hearing processes that have been closer to 2 years. But the DHCD changed the regulations back in 2008. And now this board is on 180-day time clock. So just wanted to make sure that you kept that in mind. Now, that does not mean that you're always done within 180 days, because sometimes the applicant needs additional time to get information that's been requested, and they will agree to continuances. Right. But I just wanted to make sure that the board was, you know, cognizant of that particular issue.
Yeah.
And if you wanted me to address the questions regarding the peer review, I actually did meet with the town planner and with the assistant town administrator earlier this week, and we had some discussions with regard to peer review, and I suggested absolutely that the board wants to endeavor to undergo peer review. I think that there may be some concerns with regard to the mechanics. This board may need to adopt a regulation to create a 53G account, accept the money from the applicant to pay the peer review engineers, but that doesn't mean you can't start the process tonight. My suggestion would be that it makes the process move much more quickly if this board authorizes staff to actually go through and submit the requests for services for peer review consultants, and then to select the peer review consultants, so that this board doesn't sort of have to micromanage that process, because that could take it from a multi-week process to a multi-month process. So I would just want to make that suggestion as well.
Okay, thank you.
And I also just wanted to clarify, I am here. My name is Paul Haverty. I am a 40B attorney, town council in many towns. I work for Blattman, Bobrowski, Mead, and Talaman. However, I am not town council here in Reading. I am here through the Massachusetts Housing Partnership Technical Review Assistance Program. And town council is actually here. He's sitting right next to me. So if he would like to introduce himself.
Hi, everybody. I'm Chrissy from town council office. So I'm happy to answer any questions as well.
Okay, thank you. Now, is this something you got to this account for a peer review that the board would have to do a vote on, or is this something that the
it's something that
town staff takes
I
care
think,
of?
And town council could speak to this if he wants to, but I think it's something to create the account. You may want to have had it on an agenda so that you can have a discussion of that, and people have noticed that you'll be talking about creating a 53G account. So that's why I suggested maybe at your next meeting you want to do that, but that shouldn't stop you from initiating the process of getting peer review consultants, because all that is creating an account so that the money can be placed in it, so that it's there to pay the consultants.
Yeah.
We also did discuss some of the areas in which the board may want to consider, and the areas in which peer review was conducted should be directed by the board. So you should be instructing staff that you want to see traffic review, site plan review, design review, stormwater review, that sort of thing. And any other review you may have.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you. John,
that's it.
Okay. Si, anything you would like to add?
Some of the board members have already stole a lot of my steam, but this is the start, okay, of a hopefully won't be a very complicated process. And if we all work together to a common good, then maybe we can get to a decision point sooner than 180 days. There are a lot of issues that are raised in this thing, which I think we're going to have to go through one at a time with the various departments in the town. One that stuck me right between the eyes initially, which I hadn't heard anywhere this evening, was the whole issue of the fire department's concerns about access to that facility, either from the rear or the front or underneath it, in terms of if you had to. And there are several other things there, but we'll get to that, I think, as the process goes on. I just view this night as an introduction. Good presentation. It was good. Well done. And I think we need to hear from the public, too, and I would hope and encourage the public during this whole process to stick with us and, you know, come to every one of these meetings, and we want to hear from you. And we want to make sure that your concerns are dealt with just as much as the town's concerns are dealt with. And so you're part of the process, and I hope you will continue to be part of the process, okay? I just leave it at that for now.
Okay. Thank you, Si. Eric, anything you'd like to comment on?
Well, just, you know, everyone's commenting on how tonight's really introductory. You know, we're not going to get into the substantive matters. But I did have maybe a technical foundational question about what a limited dividend organization is, how that structure, just broadly, I know it's very technical, how that works, how it intersects with the town and subsidies. So if you could just, in just maybe broad strokes, I know highly technical, exactly how does that play out on your end with the finances?
It's actually much simpler than that.
Great.
At the outset of the process, it's simply a matter of during the eligibility application process that they inform the subsidizing agency that they will be acting as a limited dividend organization. And that's that.
Okay.
At the end of the process, they then enter into a regulatory agreement and deed restrictions that will limit them in terms of the profit they're allowed to get. And that is what creates the limited dividend organization.
What is a typical limit for that?
Well, on a rental, it actually is sort of a sliding scale, depending upon when you look at it, depending upon what the 10-year treasury bill is on that particular date.
Okay.
It's 4.5 points above what the 10-year treasury is. But that is something that you can look at in this process, but not until the end of the process. That is when you would take a look. And the way that works, and that's something that I probably should have brought up sooner as well, because that's a question that's very, very frequently asked. And it ties into the time period that the board has to act. Because many times I've been involved in 40B processes where a board has considered that they wanted to do some sort of a pro forma peer review, but they've strung out the process to the point where they've reached their 180-day period. They've requested extensions from the applicant. And the applicant has been willing to grant the extensions, but not for the purpose of conducting a peer review. In order to conduct a peer review, you actually have to have completed all of your review of the process. You need to have prepared a draft decision with all the conditions that will be applicable. You have to present that to the applicant. The applicant then has to inform the board that they will not live with that decision, that they determine that decision renders the project uneconomic. In that situation, the board can then say, well, we appreciate your feedback, but we'd like to get an independent party to take a look and peer review this.
Got it.
So you can do that as long as you leave yourself enough time in the process.
Glad we brought it up tonight.
Yes. I would have reminded you of something.
That's it, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you, Eric. I myself had went through the your plan here submitted. I had a number of comments, and I'll just try to hit those as points now, or bullets, in regards to what I saw here. Number one, I saw no landscaping plan or any addressing of buffer zones. I was very concerned with the parking that goes right up to the property line. I don't know how you're going to have any buffer if the parking's right to the property line on some of these. That's a concern. Let's see, proposed utility details. I'd like to see those as you progress along. Manholes, water taps, etc. Utility room in the building. Electric cable, telephones, outside transformers. I believe you're going to need all that, and that should be addressed and shown on the plans. The way you have your plan now, it's very, very tight. I don't know where you're going to put some of this stuff, but you know that's an issue for you. We need trash. We need dumpsters. Where is this all going to go? Concerned like the fire department is with the height of getting under the building. I don't know where your dumpster is going to be, but how are you going to get a rubbish truck to the dumpster if he has to go under your building? The height just isn't going to work on that. You need a snow plan. Where are you going to plow? Though, looking at your architect's plans tonight, I saw, with the you might say the glazing, the windows on the ground floor, I was envisioning an open area where you'd get snow blowing in, but obviously you may not now have a lot of that. But it'd still be a concern, the cleanup there. Another concern I had was loading area. You're proposing 77 units. Where are these people? How are they going to move in? You have no loading area at all for these people. Is there a separate elevator to bring up furniture, to bring up anything? Service elevators as opposed to regular elevator. I don't know. I think it needs to be addressed. Fire safety. Obviously, the fire department has a number of concerns in battling a fire or something. They can't get vehicles near it or to the back or whatever. I have a concern about medical emergencies. Are you going to be able to get typically when there's a ambulance run, you have the town ambulance, you have a fire department, a fire truck goes along with it, the police go along with it. How are they all going to fit under that building? I don't see how they could on that. How are they going to access for medical emergencies, etc.? Parking to me seems inadequate, though I know you explained that you have 77 units and you're only accounting for one parking space per unit, which seems very, very minimal to me. I don't know how that's going to work. I looked at the handicap park, and I don't believe that meets handicap parking regulations. You have two spaces, and it just didn't seem adequate. And that's something I'll have to note to the town engineer, though I think the building inspector noted that in his memo, and I know the building inspector did. So it's something you might want to check. Storm drainage infusion into the groundwater, I know is something that's done all the time now. Number one, I think we need some percolation tests to be done. I would like to see that. And then what would the impact of infusing stormwater into the ground, how is that going to impact butters? I don't know, is it going to increase groundwater table on the butters' properties and give them problems with water in their basements or cellars? The shadow plan I looked at, and I saw you go through that tonight. It seemed the times, I don't know, maybe that's standard in the practice, but 10 o'clock, what was it, 10, 12, and 2:30 or something like that? It seems to me you're going to have much, much greater shadows, and I know you did December, you said that's the worst, and at 2:30 in the afternoon, obviously, it's getting towards dark then, but I'm thinking June 21st at 7 o'clock at night, the sun hasn't, it's just setting. That shadow is going to be cast quite a distance. But it looked like, too, most of the shadows were heading towards the depot area and towards the Lincoln Street area. It wasn't affecting the residences across the street on Prescott or the ones on behind on Washington. Yeah, there. It just seems to me overall that the site appears inadequate. It almost looks like you looked at it and, well, we're going to put in 77 units, and how much parking can we get? Okay, we can only get 80 spaces. Well, that's one space per unit. That's enough. It looks like you should look at it like, we got 80 spaces. How many units can that support? And it seems like you're going to need more. I don't know where anybody's visitors are going to park on there. It just seems very, very light for the parking. And the other thing I looked at was just in my head, the construction of it, how it's going to be constructed, how is the contractor going to get in there, how is the various subcontractors going to be working, where's the lay down area going to be. You're going to be bringing in all kinds of material. You're going to have an on-site trailer, probably, I would suspect. I don't know. Where's the project office going to be, the construction office, et cetera? I would like to see a plan on this, maybe addressing the construction aspect of it. What's going to be happening here? Where the laydown area is going to be? Where's material is going to be brought into? Where's that storage going to be? And that's pretty much it. I think they covered quite a bit of it, but those are concerns that I have on there.
I could probably, the team could probably answer all, they're all good points, and we could answer all of them tonight. They'll be better answered by your peer review consultant.
Right.
I don't expect you to take everything we say and believe it 100%.
Exactly.
It's a process that we look forward with the peer review consultant to answer all those, some sooner than later. And so we think that
really
will come out during that process.
Another concern, sanitary concern. You have 77 units here, wastewater being developed. Certainly, probably 7 times more to 10 times more than what's being discharged from that site now, where you have a moving storage facility with probably one or two bathrooms in it. You have a vacant building that used to be certainly wood that probably had one or two bathrooms in it. So you're talking maybe a half a dozen bathrooms. Now you're coming up with 77, I'm assuming 77 baths. Some of them may have a bath and a half. But it just seems it's a possibility of overwhelming the sanitary system in this area. Yeah, I think you're going to have to. That's
technical items.
Well, that's going to be part of the peer review, etc. And we would expect engineering to be reviewing that. Okay, those are some of the questions I have here on that. I think we can proceed now. Everybody wants to into the public comment, or would you like to maybe take a break? We've been just in here an hour and a half. Would anybody like to get up, stretch your leg, get a drink of water? Or? No? Yes?
You mentioned that you have a microphone you can pass around.
Okay, sure. Okay, we'll open up the public portion of the meeting now. Be welcome to take any comments. Why don't I start it off? Okay, no, I'll be right with you. We had one, and I believe this was an email that came into the town, and I received it. And I will go ahead and read this in from an abutter. Couldn't be here tonight. So this will be the first comment from an abutter tonight on this, on the public portion. I am unable to attend the Zoning Board Appeals public hearing tonight regarding the proposed Chapter 40B development at 3741 Lincoln Street and 212 Prescott Street, but wanted to express the many concerns I have regarding this proposed project. As someone who grew up in Reading and returned to raise my own family, I am saddened by the changes happening in this town. This proposed project does not fit in with the scale of the neighborhood or even the town of Reading. I cannot begin to imagine a building over 30 feet taller than any other building in Reading Center and being built so close to a residential neighborhood or even built in a town at all. Additionally, the proposed density of the development appears to be far greater than any other similar project built in Massachusetts, parentheses, as based on 2009 Mass Housing Study. Why is the density of this project so out of line with other similar projects? Reading is a town, not a city. The density of this proposed project does not fit in with the density of this lovely town. Another concern is the limited parking of one space per unit. This area, as everyone in Reading is well aware, has an existing parking issue because of the nearby depot. How will this new project impact commuters and the already difficult job of getting a parking space at the depot? A final major concern is essentially zero setback of this proposed building from the sidewalk. This proposed building sounds like an eyesore that will not fit into our town's historical homes in that area. I do not have a complete understanding of the 40B laws rules, but it appears that this project is a done deal. And this is just the community's chance to verbalize any concerns with the hopes that the scope scale of the project can be modified. I am hoping that this is incorrect and there is truly a way to stop this project from moving forward at all. Our town and school budgets are already stretched to the limits, and adding a project with this density will only stretch the town even more. I have difficulty understanding why new apartments and condos are being built in every available space instead of providing opportunities for much needed commercial projects and businesses. Many families move to Reading because of the wonderful reputation of the school system and the reputation that Reading is a quiet, family-friendly town. Unfortunately, I fear that this is no longer the case if projects like the one proposed on Lincoln and Prescott Streets receive approval. Thank you for your time, and I hope this proposed project can be significantly modified, if not halted completely. Please ensure that the members of the Zoning Board of Appeals and the Community Planning and Development Commission are forwarded this email. Respectfully, Rebecca Scrome, 18 Berkeley Street, Reading. And that's what we received. That is what we received via an email today from a resident who could not attend tonight. Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Could we get some ground rules here?
Sure.
Can we limit the amount of time a person has to speak? And perhaps can we limit that they can only bring up one item? And that way, maybe we can get through.
Right. We're not here tonight for a back and forth or anything. We're not going to be coming back to you with rebuttals and answers. Stand up, make your comments. It'll be noted, and we will proceed then. I think that's the way to proceed with this. And certainly, as we say, this is the start of the meetings. We are going to be having numerous other meetings on this project. And certainly, we hope you all attend those. Okay.
Also, sorry, please state your name and address for the record.
Yes. First comment?
Okay. Make sure they're all sworn in, too.
Yeah. Okay. What am I going to do? Name and address first.
I live at 76 Washington Street. I'm a direct abutter of the proposed development. And I look forward to receiving an invitation to discuss with the developer privately because I have not received such an invitation. So my main comment I'd like to make is in response to a comment that was made to the, by the developer about the fact that there is nothing to preserve about the site. I think there's one thing that's very important to all the abutters that we will lose with a project like this, and it's our privacy. So the building right now is a tall building that no doubt needs revitalization, but no one lives there. With the proposed development, we will have a five-story tall structure with no buffer zone that looks directly into our backyards. I think there was a comment made by the developer saying that they would work with us to either put some landscaping, which I see being very, very challenging given that all the site is going to be paved. And also there was a comment about, you know, if they might work with us to put vegetation on our property, which I find quite shocking that this would even be proposed. And I look forward to hear about some kind of vegetation that is 60 feet tall that grows in less than 50 years. So, you know, overall, I will say that this is quite shocking as a proposed development project. You know, the image we saw from the gentleman from Cube 3 showing the Google Earth image, you know, the scale of the project that's shown there, our houses look like dog houses relative to the scale of this. It just feels completely out of scale. The last comment I'll make is it seems like in all the assumptions that were made so far in the traffic assessments and the utilities and so on, there's always an assumption that there's only at maximum 77 vehicles that are going to be part of the of this site. We all know that this is wishful thinking. If people would only own cars when they have a dedicated parking spot, there would be no cars in the North End or in downtown Boston, and we know that that's not the case. You know, there's nothing to prevent a couple from moving into a one-bedroom apartment, and I don't see why a couple wouldn't have two cars if one person works in downtown Boston and the other person works in Waltham, for example. So I think that's what I wanted to say. The last point I'll make is the parking situation is very concerning. Washington Street during a weekday in front of the park is quite a mess for parking-wise. So I would invite the boardman to come and see, if you haven't seen it firsthand, how the parking situation can be chaotic on that street.
Thank you.
Hello, Eileen Manning at 78 Riverside Drive. And Mr. Zucker had mentioned the current building being not that great looking. I'd like him to also take a look at the neighborhood that he's putting it in. Because while that building's not great looking, we'd like it to look like the neighborhood. And it's the size, the scale, and the density of this unit is far beyond what that neighborhood can support. It seems to be beyond what most 40B developments have in similar towns. The only towns I could find with a similarly dense development were in Lowell or in Haven. And the density at 30 Haven, which you called a comparable site, seems to be about 60 units per acre. A normal transit smart growth seems to be about 20 units per acre. It looks like this is about 100 units per acre. So I think we'd be happy to see 60 units.
Hi, my name is Rhonda Holt. I live on Fairview Ave. So many concerns, and it's hard to pick just one. But my concern is our neighborhood has had flooding issues since I moved in, which was 20 years ago. We've also had times had sewer come up through our sinks. The town did resolve that. They removed the sewer drain. There's still, in heavy rains, which happens quite often, serious water issues running down our street. I mean, the storm drain gets backed up, the whole street gets backed up with water. And I'm concerned, I'm not sure which way the water flows exactly or which way the storm drains are heading. I'm not an expert. But 77 units is a lot of, like you said, a lot of wastewater. It's a lot of toilets flushing. I don't know how that's going to fit into the storm drains that we have existing already without putting in a whole new system. So that was my one point, is I'm concerned that it may make a flooding issue that we already have that much worse. Next.
Thank you. I'm representing Sam Horn. I just want to mention the ADA units, that the other 40B town is actually barely compliant. And the concern is that the building wasn't compliant, so I just wanted to make sure that the building is compliant along with the ADA regs.
Peter Rapp is 21 Prescott Street in Reading. I'm real close to this thing, and it's out of character. It's too big, it's too tall, and it's simply out of character for the neighborhood. Imagine living in a house with, 100 windows looming over you. And I don't think anyone wants to live like that. Everything the architect said is probably going to disguise it and make it fit in and look shorter and look like it might fit in, but it won't. It is simply too big. And instead of calling it Reading Village, they should call it Reading Towers.
Hi, my name is Stefan Wenish. I live at 38 Mile Street, just down the road from the old development. I'd actually like to say that I too am going to feel the effects of this development, but I look at it quite a different way. I think this is a great opportunity to get some real new life into this community. I think that if you really imagine what's there now, I mean, it's really not, you know, I think this is a really great thing that it could turn into. And for us to really focus on just really narrow things, I mean, it's not a greenfield development. We're not developing in the middle of the field, it's in the middle of the town. I mean, we're gonna have lots of concerns and lots of things that we can work through, but I'm sure we can do that. But I'd really like to ask everyone here to really think about, like, you know, what really could we possibly do better with a semi-abandoned warehouse and a defunct furniture retailer. I mean, it's a stone's throw away from the train station, and I cannot believe that there's going to be a lot of people who want to live there because it's close to the station, and they can just travel wherever they want without having a big impact on the rest of the town.
Christine Lusk, 52 Washington Street. I have a comment on the parking and the traffic. And my concern with the parking is everybody knows there's no parking in that connected area because of the commuter. And while the developer says it will help downtown traffic, what I'm afraid of is any visitors coming to visit somebody living are going to park in the 2-hour parking that currently supports them on Lower Haven and will actually detract from downtown, because I feel like there's just an awful amount of parking spaces right now for Lower Haven. So I'm really curious where visitors are going to park. Another thing is, for the traffic study, we looked at the oranges points and said, you know, 38% are going to go this way and 33% that way. I don't have the percentages right. But it wasn't mentioned that most people are going to exit the building on Prescott Street, come up and take a left onto Washington Street, which is a really narrow street as of it is right now. It's not safe. It's not unsafe, but I don't think a fire truck can get down there now with the cars on both sides. And there's a playground there. So if you take, 33% of 1,000 cars a day, 900 cars a day, that's a lot of cars zipping down a really congested street with a playground with a toddler park. So I really encourage the traffic study to really examine the impact on that very tiny street, and it has a very sharp curve with no sidewalk currently. And so that street always concerns me driving as it is. Thank you.
Can we hold the applause after the comments? And, you know, it's, we understand everybody, you know, is concerned, and you do agree with the person commenting and everything, but let's just hold the applause, please.
Caden Thomases, I live at 21 Arlington Street. Arlington Street is a one block long street that runs behind Lincoln and between Woburn and Prescott. And a lot of people who are traveling on Woburn Street and on Prescott Street use our street as a cut through, especially when there's train traffic. It's a street that has 11 houses on it. It has 18 units in those 11 houses. It has about 35, 40 adult residents and a few children. And we have 10 parking spaces on the street, which are primarily used by residents. I have neighbors who have a weekly game night. My mother was very sick for a while and needed a lot of in-home care. So there are people who might, like my mother and myself and my neighbors, need to use those 10 parking spaces. When those 10 parking spaces are filled up all at one time, there is only one lane of traffic to go through. So if all 10 spaces are filled and you want to go down the street, hopefully there's no cars coming the other direction. There's just simply no way for a parked car and two cars to pass each other at the same time on the street. It's the closest, if the entrance to the building is going to, or the pedestrian entrance is going to primarily be on the Prescott Street side of this building, it seems to me, just spending a lot of time on the ground right there, I have sight lines from my home to the current building on Prescott Street. It just seems that Arlington Street, our little street, is going to be the street where people park. And it's that on-street parking is really significant to the residents. And I would hope that people in this new building would have visitors and would have in-home health care if they needed it. And that those people have a right to park somewhere too. Where will they park? I'm very concerned.
I'm John Barnes. I live on Pratt Street in Reading. May I ask a question and then have a comment?
Sure.
I think Mr. Green raised the issue of the variances versus the waivers, and I understand the distinction in terms of the standard for the ZBA, for the town, to assess whether to grant a variance. I'm not familiar with what the standard is, if there is any. What authority does the ZBA or the town have, and what's the standard to decide whether or not to grant the waivers, any waiver that's requested in this process?
Okay.
So the standard would be you have to look at the project as a whole, and whether or not all of the conditions that are placed on the project would render the project uneconomic. If that is the case, that the conditions are found to render the project uneconomic, the next analysis is whether or not there are local concerns with regard to health, safety, design, open space, things along those lines, that outweigh the regional need for affordable housing. It's a very difficult standard to meet. It has been done with certain instances, safety issues being, you know, the most likely that would outweigh the regional need. But generally, if the conditions render the project uneconomic, they're going to be overturned if there's an appeal.
I guess then my only comment would be, other than to say that I echo many of the concerns that have been raised, and I echo all of the comments, including the gentleman that expressed the value of a project like this and the value of bringing in new blood and a vibrancy in the town. And I understand the value, and I endorse the value. I'm sure many people here do as well. And I understand the value to the Commonwealth for the need for a 40B. legislation to allow for more affordable units, and I endorse that in this town as well. But the issue, I think, is, as with all things, the only comment that I make is that it's balancing, and everything is a balancing. The question isn't whether or not this project would add value or having the new life in the town of varying diverse levels of either economics or other factors. That's a value to the town. It's a question of how the project integrates into the thread of the town as it has been woven by all of us who live here. And I guess that's my concern, as I think I've heard a lot of people express, is I just think that the waiver request, now the zoning bylaws represent the town's, their bylaws, their laws and the requirements that we all have to abide by, but they are the standards that this town has adopted for what it wants and expects its residential neighborhoods, its commercial neighborhoods, all of it, what it wants this town to look like and to exist as in terms of its health and safety and welfare. And when I look at this list, and I see that they're looking for, in terms of the dimensional controls, the lot size. The requirement is 100,000 square feet, apparently, and this lot size is 36,000. I mean, 36,000 square feet, that's significantly reduced from what this town expects the lot size to be for a project like this. The maximum building height, we've heard about that, the standard is 35 feet. And the request is for 57.5 feet. That's a significant increase from what this town wants to look like and wants to be. The off-street parking, you address that. The maximum lot coverage is 25%. This request is for 71% lot coverage. The side setback is 20 feet. The request is for 3 to 10 feet. The front setback is 15 feet. The request here is for 1.5 to 11. The rear setback is 20. The proposal is for 5.6 to 8.5. It doesn't conform to the lot shape. It doesn't conform to virtually all of the, not the requirements, but the expectations that we have for what this town should look like. And I guess all I would say is they're not there because they are per se legal requirements. They're there because that's what we want this town to look like. And I value the value of the project, but I just would like it to more conform to what we expect. And in looking at this, the bulk, the mass, and the size, the fit on the site is completely out of line with any of those standards, with all due respect. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Phil Brown. I'm a newcomer to Reading. I've only been here for 83 years. I'm going to be candid with you folks. The reason that we're here tonight is because Reading has been a snob town. And that goes way back to the 20s, when people didn't want children coming into little shacks and have to pay their school bill. So I think this is an opportunity to be part of that. I also think that perhaps there's some land that the town is sitting on that could help out on this 10%. I've only been yapping at them for about 10 years now. And that's it. Thank you.
I'm Mick Aiello. I own a home on Washington Street that the backyard abuts the project. And I just wanted to, I guess, support some of my neighbors. And I think that the setbacks or lack of setbacks are just really concerned. I think if anybody, even if you don't have a property that abuts it, if you could imagine something that's 50 to 60 feet virtually on your property line and the impact that would have. I recognize the value of the project too, but I think if you think about that, you can see where most of us that are right there are have concerns. I don't see any buffer zone. I don't see any vegetation. I have had the same offers of putting vegetation on my property. But I just think it's just the sheer mass and the scale. I'm not opposed to the project in general. I'm opposed to the fit isn't right. The other thing I want to mention quick is groundwater was mentioned today, and that's something I hadn't really thought about. I do get water in my basement when we get heavy rain, and those aren't like 100-year storms or whatever. That's just heavy rain. So I'm not sure how this plan that was proposed would deal with that, but that is a concern of mine.
Traffic study be required to extend far beyond the triangle.
because we have intersection of Lincoln Street and Woburn, we have High Street and Woburn, we have Haven and High Street, and we have the Washington Street and Main Street intersections, which are seriously impacted today without any contribution from additional residential properties there. The, interestingly enough, the town would probably be very happy if we redeveloped the site as a multi-layered parking structure.
Hi, John Weston, Ken Wendor Babb, CBBC member as well. I do want to mention, talk about the parking study and some advice for a little bit more work. Great what was done so far. I think the other piece of this really needs to be the pedestrian, a pedestrian study, because if I remember correctly, there's going to be some, 500 trips generated based on the IPE data. And if half of, just the assumption is that half of the trip generation will be not by cars, but by people. Most of those people will all be walking over the train tracks, over that intersection up to Haven Street. It's a pretty good assumption there. Right now someone pays for police officers to stay there during the peak hours because of the pedestrians crossing the street. I know a few years back we had a whole design charrette, design effort about the concern partially about pedestrians at that intersection on the other side of the tracks, and just that number of people crossing the tracks, which is dangerous. So I would encourage that whatever peer review firm that we have, we also look at the pedestrian generation, pedestrian environment coming out of this as well.
David O'Sullivan, 87 Sunnyside. I think the architects did a nice job of the building, making it look good. I am concerned over density. I think what would be very helpful is, at one time, this site was considered as part of the 40R downtown district. So to compare this, what they're proposing, with the 40R standards that the town put into place, had a lot of thought and effort, to kind of compare this to that. Also, would be interesting to note, if someone could find out, actually, how many cars per unit is in 30 Haven, because that would give us probably the best data, the closest data, to whether this has enough parking or not. So that if we could find out, I know 30 Haven has a lot more two bedrooms, but maybe we could find out how many cars, how many people, and that would help give all of us good information, as well as the developer, to see what to expect for cars. I do agree it's probably a little too dense, but I think it can be worked on. And I do agree that putting something that's more viable than a warehouse is a smart idea.
The concerns about the school system, I would be too concerned about. I just did a recent, I'm coming up on my 50th year of town meeting. I come in 1967, so I went back and did a little interesting work. There was 500 more students in 1967 than there is in the school system right now. So, and another thing that you might want to know, back in, I think, 1980s or so forth, They forecasted that Reading would be a 35,000 population, so we've never got there. And the site that we're talking about, as a child, I remember playing over it was an industrial site, and the other place was a hairbrush factory.
Prescott Street. One thing that I would like to request that we see at a future meeting is, other than two sides of a small piece of the building, is to see architectural drawings from about 300 feet back in all directions. Because I know that if you stand on the other side of the train tracks and now look in the direction of the two buildings, and you see the distance from where certainly Wood is, encompassing the Doucette building, it's massive. And I think that the drawings that you have done are lovely, but I don't think they give us a clue to the mass and scale, the size of that building.
Eileen Manning, Riverside Drive. I'd like to ask for a point of clarification on the point about in a 40B process that the only thing that trumps the need for affordable housing is safety. My understanding is that there's significant, you know, town concern, particularly about density, is that we can ask the developers to make adjustments, and the burden of proof then comes on them to say that it's uneconomic for them and that it's not truly just a safety.
I didn't say just safety. So local concerns are safety, health, safety, open space, design, and other issues of local concern.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
This is Julie Aylward from Prescott Street. I'm not sure if this is the right time to ask this, but I'm curious if the developers could share what their return on investment is based on the letter that got approved, and what in the 40 process is the maximum allowed return on investment, and I'm just wondering what we have to work with before it becomes uneconomical.
Okay, I believe, aren't they regulated by the state in regards to what the profits can be on a 40B?
Yes, I stated that limitation earlier, which is 4.5 points over the 10-year treasury yield. I don't know what their pro forma showed in terms of what was approved by Mass Housing. Again, the way the process works is the board should be looking at what their site concerns are, taking a look at the impacts of the development, and making a determination from there whether or not it needs any sort of changes, reductions, something along those lines. And once it's done that, it then takes a look at the project economics to see whether or not the proposed changes that the board wants to see made would render the project uneconomic. The first thing the board should be focusing on is how to make this a project that fits into the neighborhood and doesn't create the health, safety, and other concerns discussed in the regulations and the statute.
Thank you.
Everett
Lodge, 99 Prescott Street. I have some multifaceted questions because I think it's a very multifaceted issue. Mostly, I guess initially, is sewage. Two times in the last 10 years, and I'm talking sewage, I'm not talking stormwater. We had a turn at the back of our yard, which is where I came out of the building, and I came home from work at Reading Memorial High School, and I found that turn cover 2.5 feet in the air because of water in the sewage. I just think the number of units, 77 units, 77 sinks, 77 showers, 77 dishwashers, washing machines, is going to be a big impact on the sewage of that whole street. And I set halfway, almost up to Summer Ave. So it's a big issue of sewage. I also think it's a very multifaceted issue because some of the things are looked at and some things are not. They say, well, they could use Uber or they could use taxis. We don't have taxis. Maybe Zipcar. I don't know where you get a Zipcar here. The only one I thought was in town is no longer here. And food.
There is no real general all food store other than the butcher shop downtown. That's a walk, and again, the traffic study should be looked at further around, because that's a walk down Washington Street, down toward Ash, and cut through the back way. That's the shortest way. That's a hazardous walk. There's places, there's not even a crosswalk there. On the corners, you cut down toward municipal light building down that way. So there's, I think it's a very big issue. I'm very much in favor of diversity and low income and expanding the variety of people in town. I have no problem with that. But I wouldn't want 56 feet of building next to my lot. I just don't think it's fair. It just doesn't hit right. I'm with the Board of Parker Tavern, and I'm going to have a tough time explaining next year to the third graders, of which all third graders come to Reading, and we talk about that 1 acre of land there, and they're growing their own food, and looking across and seeing what my wife talked about as a massive building, and explaining the lack of green.
Is there any further comments or questions?
I have a question. Could I ask another question? This is sort of maybe a 40B question. I know they said, so there's 77 units proposed, and 20% go to the affordable housing. But they said the other units, the rest of the, it's all 77 units, could count towards that 10% number, because it would be Section 8 housing.
No. So what the state has done?
These other buildings that we have, why those other units don't count towards that, and this particular building would?
What the state has done with regard to incentivizing the creation of rental development is to allow all of the units in a rental affordable rental development to count towards the town subsidizing inventory, even though only either 20% or 25% are actually affordable. So it's a policy issue that's been decided by the state to count them, even though they're not actually affordable.
And when did this, begin? Like, when did they just make this determination?
It's been, I don't know, Jeff, do you know?
It was far longer
than I've been involved in Jeff before.
Basically, a deal cut many years ago between the 1970s. State and municipalities, because there was not much rental housing being developed. I want to say 15 years ago or so. So they said because it's basically one deed, the whole community is one project, we will count 100% of the units. I mean, a town like where I live in Newton, we have several really large rental developments, and the city said, look at us, we have, 2,000 units of affordable housing. When people that really care about affordable housing, legitimately they have about 500, because 1,500 of them are market units. But relative to getting to the 10% threshold, a 40B project, a rental development, 100% of the development counts. But some of your other questions, the town may have, and I don't know this for certain, sometimes there's special permit projects permitted through the planning board, and if you don't have 20% or 25%, you could have 18% in a rental development. Only that percentage counts towards your subsidized housing inventory. So you might have many other rental projects in town, but they don't have that threshold of affordable housing. Thus, the market units are treated as market units, the affordable units are treated as affordable units. And you've had home ownership, and home ownership only the affordable units. So I don't know if that helps sort of clarify.
Okay, yeah, it does. I just, I wasn't sure why, the old Addison Wesley buildings that are going in there. Like, it seems like everything was built, it has affordable housing as a part of it. But I'm wondering why some are limited to counting towards that total and some weren't.
Yes. I missed the distinction. I think just one of the things, the distinction I think that everybody was trying to make is, in rental developments, 100% of the units count towards the affordable housing. In developments where there are units for sale, only certain affordable units count toward the 10%.
Okay.
On 40B and 40B developments.
Ida Fitzgerald, Sunnyside Ave. We have two large complexes in Reading, the Archstone complex and the one that's on South Street. Might we, new blood, okay, but might we bleed if we have more new blood keep coming on in town?
There was a question earlier, and I did get a answer to that in regards to somebody was asking what the Haven Street, what the parking ratio was between units and spaces. And I've noted here that at 30 Haven, it is 1.38 parking spaces or per unit on that. So almost 1.38. parking spaces well, per unit.
We'll certainly look at that. I think a more accurate representation would be, A, what's the parking ratio per bedroom, not necessarily per unit, because they have a lot more bedrooms per unit, and B, they have, correct me if I'm wrong, 20,000 square feet of retail space that we don't have any.
Right.
So I think it's important to understand the totality of the development to compare an apple to apple.
And we will reach out again. When we reached out last time, we actually heard they had more spaces than they needed, and that was part of our determination of how we came to our count. But through this process, we'll continue to reach out to them to see what their parking needs are, so that we could adjust that if we need to in our projects.
Okay. And if I'm not mistaken, have I heard recently there is a requirement, Julie, you may know, in regards to the number of three-bedroom units that are required by the 10%. State now in a 40B project? 10% of the units. Are you aware of that?
Yes.
10% of the units in a 40B project have to be three-bedrooms.
Yes.
Okay.
We meet that requirement.
We do. We meet the requirements. Up until recently, the state allowed you to waive that, but recently they've not allowed that to be waived, so we're looking at supporting the waiver on it. It's not.
Yeah. And I know you talked upwards to, you know, what did you say, 70% of the units you were thinking would be one-bedroom units.
Currently designed as
not necessarily a single person, though, living in that one-bedroom unit. A couple, and many couples, as has been explained, could have two cars.
It's above what I do, but there's plenty of studies, and there's no studies, and then there's reality situations. So you kind of try to take your best guesstimate at, based on tons of data and information on where your parking needs will fall. And that's what you're doing. And taking into account local situations like their behavior and what their needs are. So.
Okay. If that's the case, then we'll move on here. Obviously, we're going to have more meetings. Public's invited. Comments will be taken as we go along from the public at any time. I shouldn't say any time. We will have a public comment portion of every meeting for this and to do this.
Close tonight's.
So, pardon?
Close tonight's.
Don't close the public hearing.
No, it changes the comment section. You don't have to.
It's not for
me. I think it's a little wrong thing. So.
So.
All right.
Okay, so a sign-in sheet. If everybody, there was a sign-in sheet up at the desk. If you were here, if you would sign in so we know your name and address, it would be helpful to the town. And we appreciate your attending the meeting tonight. Really, we do.
Is there another
continuation?
Yes.
Yeah, we're, let's see, our next meeting, I know, our next meeting will be taking care of local business, so we probably would not have time on the agenda for then. So we would be looking for...
Do you have any questions?
Yes, we do. Excuse me.
Here's your gavel.
Could you bring your conversations outside, please? Thank you. We're still continuing the meeting here. Our next meeting will be the 18th, and that's when we'll be doing a lot of local business there.
Yeah. Why don't you tell them to take them?
On the 23rd, yes.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Bob.
I'd like to hear what's going on, please.
Yeah, but have people take their conversations outside.
I imagine at that point you could also set up the account there so we could actually deposit. I don't know the process, as long as we can get that money. Obviously, we wouldn't want to come back to you before we met with the selectmen.
I believe that is, it sounds like that's going to take a consensus from the board on that in regards to setting up the account.
So the first thing I would do is have the board take a vote to authorize staff to solicit the bids for the peer review and to enter into contracts for the peer review.
So we can do that tonight?
You can do that tonight.
Okay.
The second part of it, I don't think you need to do anything tonight other than instruct the planner to include as an agenda item for your next meeting the issue of voting on setting up a 53G account.
Okay.
Agree with that.
I do. And you can do that at your next meeting. That does not necessarily need to be connected to the continuation of this public hearing.
Right. Because that account would not just be part of this hearing. Any time in the future when you need to do any sort of peer review of any project, that account would be used for that peer review fund.
That would be other business in addition to what we have coming up at our next meeting, which is another hearing.
It could be.
Which is the easiest way to take care of it. If
we can
move tonight.
We can take care of it in the next meeting, 2 weeks from now. We can take care of that then.
But we
put it on the agenda.
We should make a motion tonight to empower town staff to start the process.
Because that's part of this process, did not need to be noted on the agenda separately.
So why don't we do that then? I would entertain a motion on that from a member.
I move that the Board of Appeals authorize town staff to begin the process of seeking out peer review consultants for this 40B project, pending establishment of an account.
Thank you. Do I hear a second?
Pending, that means the staff can't do that until the board actually votes on the 53G or whatever it is.
You can move forward towards soliciting securing the help of a peer reviewer. We just wouldn't accept the peer reviewer is going to be paid for by the applicant. It's just a matter of not accepting the funds from the applicant until we get the account set up. But we can certainly move forward with getting the peer reviewers effectively on board, I would think.
You want me to take off pending?
Yes.
Take off the pending aspect.
Take off the pending aspect, pending opening of an account. Okay.
Because the staff is going to look into the process of.
I'll restate the motion. I move that the. Well, you seconded it.
I didn't second.
You didn't. Okay. All right. I'll restate the motion. I move that the board allow authorize town staff to begin the process of soliciting and securing peer review consultants for this 40B project.
I'll second that.
And did you want to state which aspects you wanted to begin on peer review? I mean, for instance, traffic, general civil review, design review, stormwater review. And so those, I think, would be your initial scopes.
Fire, public safety.
Fire, yes. I think
parking.
Parking, yeah.
Well, parking would be part of the traffic.
Falls under traffic. I think all what you noted, and I think the town generally knows what they're going to be looking for, right, on this, Jean?
I would say that we probably want to vote by the board so that we're going after the right thing that you're looking for.
Okay. Yeah.
So I think as an initial basis, that's a good start.
This is just initial.
And if moving forward, the board determines there's another aspect that needs peer review, you certainly, can instruct staff, at that point to solicit bids for that peer review.
Okay.
So then, I'll retract my second.
Sorry.
And I'll add to my motion traffic,
stormwater
and engineering,
fire and
public safety, municipal utilities and design review.
Yeah. And site review, general civil site reviews.
And design review.
Yeah. Okay.
I think that's broad enough.
Okay.
Now I'll second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any comments from board members? All those in favor? Okay.
and I need a date to continue to.
Right.
Oh, yeah, what date is it?
We're going to continue. We will, I'll
what's the schedule look like,
hey.
You know?
You guys are free to have a meeting. There's nothing on, no cases as of yet.
No cases on the 18th?
No, not as of yet.
Nothing right now?
No.
We could do the 18th, or we could...
Well,
sorry.
Yeah, wait a minute. That's February 18th.
That's February 23rd.
That's right.
I'd go to the first quarter of March.
March 3rd.
March 3rd.
And March 17th.
Right.
March 3rd will be our first meeting in March, and that would be after the selectmen's and CPD meeting on that then. So that's...
March 3rd works. March 3rd. I always take the more meetings, the better in terms of trying to get the project to the point where everyone's...
Okay.
Well, at the same time, we need to balance with what may be coming through the local channels, too. Yeah.
That's what I said. Right now, we have nothing for the next meeting, which is the 18th of February. We have no locals, but...
But you do want to leave time for the flow of information to catch up and give you things to review.
I guess it's the process. There's obviously a big step is getting peer review and the ability for us to
Getting that set up.
That peer review and giving them time. So the question is, you know, how long will that take? If the next meeting we set up a 53G account and we could quickly put that in, how long does that? I guess part of the process from the peer review control how long would it?
So the vote for the 53G account can occur at their next regularly scheduled meeting, which is in 2 weeks.
Right.
So that should be in place and ready to go, and that's not going to hold them up from soliciting the bids on the peer review. So certainly the peer review should be in place by the next meeting. I don't know if they will have completed their reviews by then or not. I mean, that's a matter of timing, I would guess.
I would doubt it. 2 weeks. Yeah,
there's
a lot of
We also need direction from selected meetings on the 23rd, so we scheduled too close. We're not going to get that. So March 3rd probably would be the appropriate time.
I think March 3rd. I think March
3rd. 17th
is bad for me.
Yeah.
I'm Irish. I'm sorry. March 17th.
Maybe
that's like a family holiday.
The 17th, the 2 weeks after. Which would give the peer review, if it works out, a month to review and have a report to come back to, and gives us time if they have comments that we don't hear on that day for the first time. So maybe from a process standpoint, maybe it's better to wait till the second hearing in March. If it was
the second hearing in March is the 17th.
Right.
Which is also a date that some people can't make.
We've heard already some comments that people can't make that date. It's a day of celebration, I guess.
I think this dominates.
Well, it does with me. I'll be here. I'll be here, but...
I think they were concerned that I would be here.
Can't hear it in the background. With
I'm not subject to the
No.
Yours?
I mean, if you continue the 17th, I will make sure I'm here. I will not leave
I'm ready for the 17th. Yeah. Okay.
These are all.
David, you ready?
I'll be around 17.
Yeah. 17, 17 is fine.
Yeah, I'll be here. I'm not Irish.
Applicants comfortable with the 17th right now? The next meeting? Okay. Request a continuation. Do we need this from the developer then to request this? Or we just board?
We'd have to ask you, right?
No, you do not need to request.
No, just
from the developer.
Yeah. Continuation of this. I'll entertain a motion for a continuation from a board member then on till the 17th.
So moved.
So moved. To the 17th of March. Do we have a second from
second.
David? All those in favor of the continuation of this to March 17th? So be. Next meeting will be March 17th, to be determined. Let me say this, whether it will be here or up at the selectman's room, at town hall, we'll see. The town will let you know.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I would...
Yeah, we have to...
All right, motion to adjourn. Motion, right, I was just saying, motion to adjourn from David. Do I have a second?
Second
from Si. All those in favor? Thank you.
Motion to adjourn from me, second by Si. Unanimous.
Right.